specific out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to Jesus, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away, grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth in the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals, it is impossible, but for God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house, or brothers, or sisters, or mother, or father, or children, or fields, for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive a hundredfold now in this age? Houses, brothers, and sisters, mothers, and children, and fields, with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." The Gospel of the Lord. Psalm 116, these words will give your heart a moment to center. "What shall I render to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. I will offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving and call on the name of the Lord. Times a year or every 3 weeks. So, if people come into the church and say, they're always talking about money, don't blame us. Ask Jesus, why did you talk about money so many times? Well, I think one reason that he may have spoken about money so often is to try and overturn our natural inclination to try and rationalize away some of the pointed meanings of the things he had to say to us. I don't know if you've heard this one. You know the difference between a liberal and a conservative? A liberal interprets all the passages about money in the Bible literally, but all the passages about sex figuratively. While a conservative interprets all the passages about money figuratively and all the passages about sex literally. Anyway, I don't know about that. What I do know is this. I have not met a single Christian in my experience who has 100 homes. Jesus has the right to exaggerate to make a powerful point. And I think in this case, he seems to be saying, if you are willing to give up everything in order to fall in with me and what I have in store, that you're going to be okay. Everything's just going to be fine. Okay. Another reason I think is Jesus spoke about money. He must have had an eye on us. 20 centuries later, people of our time and place. I'm going to read three names to you. Tell me what you think they have in common. Warren Buffett, Bill Gates, and Jeff Bezos. You know what they have in common?
A lot of money.
Those are the top three names on this year's Forbes list of the richest people in the world. Warren Buffett comes in a measly third place at $88.3 billion in his world. Bill Gates is now number two at only $97 billion. And with him, way out in front of Jeff Bezos of Amazon, rolls in at $160 billion net worth. When you hear those names, you hear those figures, hard to comprehend, impossible to comprehend, totally in a league by themselves, and they absolutely are. To give you a way of trying to get your head around that, if I was the president of the United States, and you know I'd earn a salary of $400,000 a year. If I put all of that money aside and saved every penny of it, you know how many years it would take me to get to $160 billion? I'd have to work for 400,000 years to get that much money. That's how much money we're talking about. And yet, even though those people's figures, I don't know your checking accounts, but I know I'm not anywhere in that universe. And yet, I think Jesus is trying to remind us, especially today, that we are the rich person in that story. We really are. According to one study, most of us rank as the richest people living in the world today. In the middle class income of a family headed by a college graduate in the United States makes that household richer than 95% of the whole Earth's population, and richer than 99.9% of all the people that have ever lived on the planet. We are the rich ones in the story. There's no doubt about it. Let me say that in a little bit of a different way. We are rich. We are rich. But whether we are the rich man in the story, that's the question. We might be. Even if you had one measly dollar to your net worth, you still might be, and might not be, the rich guy in this story. To me, the whole story turns on one word in this encounter with Jesus. Jesus says, sell what you have, give it to the poor, and follow me. And what follows is, when he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving because he had tender is strict that we're grieving to the times when we have lost someone to death. But grief and grieving is not limited to the death of a person. It can be the death of a lot of things, relationships, the loss of all kinds of losses, small or large, even imagined losses can bring grief. And I think that's the case of the guy in this story. When Jesus gave him that proposition, he grieved deeply just imagining what it would be like to get rid of all of this stuff. And imagining that it happened made him grieve for those things that he might lose. But because it hadn't actually occurred that he gave it away, he was able to walk away from Jesus and that challenge. And we don't know what happened to the guy. We don't know. I can imagine him walking away and going, at least he might have said that out loud or under his breath, but I wonder when he got home and he was with himself and the depths of his heart and soul and mind, what he might be saying. And so that's where I bring that to you and to me. Let's put ourselves in the place of that man. And imagine that Jesus asked you to give up something, asked you to give up everything. Imagine Jesus asked you to give up a very precious relationship in your life. What would you say to him? And I'm not talking to the you that sit in church around other church people who would probably think to yourself, yes, I stand up and I say, yes, of course I would do that. I'm talking to the you who, when you go home and is in your private time, is reflecting on this in the depths of your own soul, what would you say? Let that be a rhetorical question. But while you're pondering, I'm going to propose an alternate ending to this encounter of Jesus with this rich man. When the rich man heard what Jesus said, he was shocked, but he didn't walk away. He stood there, grieving, for he had many possessions. And Jesus said to him, I can see by the look on your face that what I ask you seems impossible. And Jesus put his arm around his shoulder and said, let me let you in on something that is not a secret. impossible. For you, it is impossible. And if it weren't for the money and the possessions thing, you'd find another way to balk at what I asked, whether it's mother or father or children or whatever. How could anyone ask you to trade all those things in your life for something so intangible as what I call good news and life in what I call God's kingdom? No one would do that. No one would do that. Except me, said so if you're willing to not walk away, hang with me, believe in me, and trust in me, and if you'll be impressed by what you see that I mean, and with his dying and rising, Jesus that it is possible to take a leap of faith and give up everything, including life itself, trusting in the promises and the presence of God, and to find out that everything was given back and even more. And so now the risen Christ invites you and me to share that trust of his, because it's his trust in us, and share that experience and share that legacy. So what's the difference between the rich man in this story and you and me? Well, we get to make a choice that the rich man didn't stick around long enough to make. You can choose